Mainstream radio in 2001 was a weird time to listen in. There was loud, abrasive anger. Hyperactive teenage immaturity. Plus the usual pop bubblegum. And Andrew WK contains shades of all of the above. Heavier than almost anything else in the mainstream, but sugary sweet like the purest pop. His debut single was a Vodka Redbull, smashed directly into your ear canal. A punishingly uplifting tune released in the aftermath of the worst tragedy to befall the US in living memory. This is the story of Party Hard, and how Andrew WK is not who you think he is. This video is sponsored by Surfshark. I don't know about you, but I'm constantly on the move, so I'm frequently using public and potentially unsafe Wi-Fi hotspots. Without a VPN, you're putting your personal information in danger. Surfshark encrypts your internet data, preventing others from sniffing out your information when you're using public Wi-Fi networks in hotels, cafes, airports, etc. Surfshark enables users worldwide to protect their privacy and security. Whether on your laptop, phone, or TV, Surfshark is easy to install and able to be run on an unlimited number of devices at the same time from one subscription. So that's safe, unrestricted surfing wherever you go. You can get Surfshark VPN at the link on screen. And if you enter the promo code TRASHTHEORY, you'll receive 33% off and 3 extra months for free. Not only that, but with a 30-day money-back guarantee, you have plenty of time to try out Surfshark risk-free. So surf safely with Surfshark. And now, back to the video. Andrew WK is an odd character. Born in California, Andrew Wilkes Creer grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan, just outside Detroit. Energized by the four-on-the-floor disco stomp of his father's Hooked on Classics album, from an early age, he would take piano lessons. Far from the maximalist rock of his later career, it was here that he found that music could move him. Listening to my teachers, these guys are women who could open the lid and just play. And it was so loud, so huge, so intense. And for someone who was 11, just learning how to tap the keys, seeing that was just the most exciting thing. I became addicted to moving, powerful songs. In his teens, Wilkes Creer would encounter Mr. Bungle's debut. Mike Patton's fizzy, discordant, yet entirely bizarro mix of funk, metal, ska, and carousel music. This would then lead him onto the extreme metal and noise rock present in his local scene, finding special fondness for the structured chaos of the band Couch and their self-titled 7-inch. Such was his love for the band. The 7-inch sleeve can be seen on the back of his first EP. Though other early obsessions included Napalm Death, Obituary, and Sparks. He didn't want to replicate their sound, in the belief he would never be able to make that music as well as his heroes. He was instead inspired by intensity, energy, and volume. It wasn't, "I want to write this type of thing or write this song." It was about how loud I could possibly make this, how moving. I would hear music that I was like, "Wow, what a good sound this has. But why couldn't they make it that much louder and that much harder? Why can't he just yell out, you know?" Between 1994 and 98, within the incestuous local scene, Wilkes Creer would lend his musicianship to many, many bands, either on the keyboard, or much more in demand as the drummer. The Pterodactyls, Ancient Art of Bore, Mr. Velocity Hopkins, but there was also the psychedelia of lab lobotomy. The grindcore of cathode. As well as his creepy, John Carpenter-esque solo work. However, his prolific musical output went beyond bands that existed. At cathode practices, the band would jokingly make up fake bands, like an overweight Beastie Boys-style rap trio named the Portly Boys, or a try-hard goth punk band called Haunted Elegance. Said singer of cathode, Jeff Rice, where most people stop it at the bullshitting phase, Andrew would actually do it. The Portly Boys! The Portly Boys! The Portly Boys! Andrew came up with a fake tape label called Rockside BK. He made a catalogue of all these bands that didn't exist, wrote descriptions of all of them, and made them as outlandish as possible. And if somebody actually bought a tape, he would write and record the entire album himself, posing as a band. At the age of 18, Andrew Wilkes' career moved to New York. Motivated but lonely, his partying hard identity had yet to be fully realized. I had never been drunk, I didn't do any drugs, and I didn't have any friends. I spent a huge amount of time at home alone, which was pretty much what I did all my life. I never was a very social person. I had always felt awkward at parties. Social interaction was tricky for me, but I loved the atmosphere of being at a party, the way it felt in the air. So creating music that encouraged partying was a no-brainer. But at the back of his mind was a lingering depression that he was unable to shake. In order to mute the dark feelings he was having, Wilkes' career planned to create the loudest, most intense music, like his beloved black metal and grindcore, but instead making it blindly positive.
I wanted to feel better about life, and the thing that made me feel better consistently and reliably was music, and not just any kind of music, but a music that was focused on an extraordinarily kind of high physical energy.
Guitar was key to this, but his background was in percussion, both piano and drums, where sound is created by simply hitting the instrument. Learning guitar was more complex. You have to strum and press at the same time, two less intuitive actions. To make it easier for himself, he tuned his guitar to a power chord, so that he only needed to use one finger to hold down the strings to create the primordial building block of rock music. Without a band, early shows were just him on a keyboard, playing primitive versions of what would become Girl's Own Love. And She Is Beautiful. But at the same time, Wilkes' career was developing his public persona. Already in place was his relentless energy and all-white attire, but it wasn't enough. He wanted his own piece of iconography, so visceral that once seen, you can never forget. The idea was to have a bloody nose photo, and to make that basically my logo. So we wanted to put it on the album cover from the very beginning. We wanted it to be real blood. It had to look really good. It was a photo that was only going to be taken once, and we wanted it to be good enough to last a long time and be used over and over again. So we did our best, and it was worth the pain and suffering. Legend has it, WK smashed himself in the face with a brick, then blew his nose hard to get the required blood flow. He would use this photo as his calling card, sending it out with his demo CD. The blood-encrusted Andrew WK could not be ignored, and it started generating buzz. Due to this, Dave Grohl invited WK to support the Foo Fighters in April 2000. The first time Dave called me, I didn't know who he was. I had heard of the Foo Fighters, but I didn't know his name, but I liked his drumming for Nirvana for sure. Still lacking a band, his Foo support slot was just him, hollering along to a backing tape, much to the confusion of the audience. Despite this, with the release of the mostly keyboard-driven Party Till You Puke EP in October 2000, and the resulting buzz, WK signed a deal with Island Records. Then he vanished for 6 months. When it's time to party, we will party hard. For what would be his major label debut, I Get Wet, Andrew WK went through several producers, but the majority of the heavy lifting was done by Scott Humphrey. Andrew loved the Hellbilly Deluxe record I produced and wrote with Rob Zombie. He said, "I want my record to sound like that, but more intense." The album's undeniable feel-good energy and mission statement were encompassed by its first single, Party Hard. I wanted it to start with a riff that was one note. I had a vision of being on stage and the sound is just... no chord changes, everyone playing just one note with as much intensity as they could. I wanted it to be this heartbeat. There was no question as to whether I would include piano. It's a real rock and roll instrument. It's percussive, it has power, and it's all I could play. To achieve that monstrously intense sound, he recorded dozens of layers of guitar, full of little fuck-ups and imperfections, to create an impossibly full sound, an impenetrable wall of guitar. Thousands of hours were put into making sure that the songs didn't sound like they had thousands of hours put into them. Andrew WK had used this all guns blazing approach in his demos. But Humphrey was the one that suggested that having the intensity at 11 all the time was going to tire listeners out, that he needed to create small moments of relative quiet as contrast. It's like painting. You can't make everything super bright, because then it's just white and there's nothing on the canvas. Finally, I'm like, "Andrew, check this out. You hired me because you liked Hellbilly Deluxe. In this song, when the chorus ends, there's just one little instrument playing for two bars. Then bang, everything comes back in and it sounds huge." Through happenstance, Andrew WK had sent Donald Tardy of Florida Death Metal Crew Obituary a fan letter and managed to convince him to play on the album. Even in the presence of one of the blast beat kings of the Sunshine State, WK was very adamant that the drums should match what he had in his head. Said Tardy, "If you picture an AC/DC song, it's a bass drum, then a snare, bass drum, then a snare. 1, 2, 3, 4. With I Get Wet, you're kicking on the bass drum every time." Andrew loved that. Even when I mixed it up and tried to bring a little bit of my style into it, it still sounded better if I took Andrew's word and played 4 on the floor. Impressed with WK's project, he would return to Florida and assemble a band from the local scene. Bassist Greg Roberts and guitarist Frank Werner of the band Intoxicated, as well as additional guitarists Eric Payne and Jimmy Koo. Party Hard is one of 3 songs on Andrew WK's debut that has Party in its title, alongside It's Time to Party, it's time to party, let's party, and Party Till You Puke. As such, he took a Viv Savage style philosophy of have a good time all the time and made it his own manifesto. "I'm not making this music because I'm a positive person. I'm someone who's been negative, desperately looking for something to do with my life that allows me to experience these positive emotions that I have a deficit of." While other party anthems would have a us versus them dynamic, partying in spite of some antagonistic force, be it parents, authority, society. Party Hard, in its language, welcomes all that want to join in. You are invited. Furthering this aspect, Andrew WK made sure that no one was left out, never explicitly qualifying what partying hard meant. I didn't want anyone to feel like they had to act a certain way to party. I'd had many life experiences that told me something about me was wrong, or I couldn't be part of this club, all that crap. I hated being at a party and someone coming up and saying, "Why aren't you drinking? Why aren't you dancing?" So I thought, I'm gonna make a song telling people to party, but party however they want. I never dictated what people should specifically do. As an unknown artist with major label money behind him, it was decided that Andrew WK should target the UK market first. Just like how the British music press Buzz had launched The Strokes and White Stripes months prior to their break in the US, the hope was that the hype machine could do the same for Andrew WK. Before he'd even released his first single, the NME dubbed him Bigger Than Jesus and the savior of music. His first live performance with his new band was at The Garage in London on the 23rd of October 2001. A showcase for this new talent, the music press were left confused and with questions. Namely, was this a joke? Was Andrew WK fucking with us? Jock rock party tunes played without a touch of irony, so supremely amped up and caffeinated that they seemed to edge on parody. But Andrew WK remained straight-faced. There was no hidden message to party art. No added layers of depth below the surface sheen. Besides countless extra layers of hyped guitars. And once revealed, the press had no time for this bubblegum metal. NME's Alex Needham fumbled for a way to describe what he was hearing. ABBA meets Slayer. A 21st century meatloaf. The death metal Elton John. Party Hard was released as a single a week later, entering the chart at number 19, before slipping off 3 weeks later. It would be his only UK top 40 single. It was in this wave of baffled promo articles that rumours started to swirl that Andrew WK was not all he seemed. The rumour is that Andrew WK is a none too elaborate joke foisted upon the world by ex-Nirvana drummer and Foo Fighter Dave Grohl. Gossip hounds reckon Grohl penned the WK anthems for a laugh and got Andrew, the long-haired sex god, to front them. The NME, Guardian and BBC all repeated this theory. Furthering the confusion, WK was also being cagey with what the WK stood for, the press disregarding the boring double-barreled truth and theorizing combinations like Women Come, White Killer, and Once Kicks.
What's the craziest thing you've ever heard it stand for?
Winter Klondike. Which I think is great. So who's to say it doesn't stand for that?
But Andrew's stock response was who knows. By the time I Get Wet had debuted on the Billboard chart in April 2002, the narrative of the Foo Fighters frontman's involvement had been erased to ask a different question. Who was Steve Mike? On the I Get Wet liner notes, he's credited as executive producer, but in one of the first Andrew WK interviews, with Dazed and Confused from late 2000, he presented himself as Steve Mike. When questioned about it by NME, he denied that ever happened. No, I was never Steve Mike. Steve Mike's his own guy. He's a really important guy. We would not be talking here if it wasn't for Steve Mike, so I have a lot of respect for him. I let him do his own thing. He's a real person, yes. Steve Mike is a real person that does exist. The uncertainty behind the Andrew WK persona came to widespread attention after a show in December 2004. Due to a noise curfew, his set was cut short, and unlike every other show he'd played, WK didn't stick around to meet with fans afterwards. Soon, the promoter started getting phone calls to the effect of, "That guy on stage wasn't the real Andrew WK." Since then, some people believe that Andrew WK had been replaced by an actor, that the person that appeared in the Party Hard video was no longer filling the Andrew WK role. 2 years went by with no tours or new music, a vacancy that was filled with rumors. Was this guy on stage the infamous Steve Mike, sick of not getting credit for inventing the Andrew WK persona and writing the songs on I Get Wet? When his third album, Close Calls with Brick Walls, did arrive in July 2006, Andrew WK had abandoned his trademark wall of bubblegum metal sound. And it received a limited release in only Japan and Korea. Worldwide availability of the album would take until 2010. WK's reasoning for this strangled release came in 2009. There was a dispute with my creative director. I wouldn't exist without the team that came up with the Andrew WK persona, but had been agreed that they would stay in the background. On the second album, they felt they should be getting more credit. Confidentiality agreements mean that I can't say much about it, but basically the legal situation meant I was prevented from releasing music. Was this creative director Steve Mike? Was it Dave Grohl? A fabrication to cover WK's label issues? Considering that he constructed a whole fake label in his teens as something to do, is it out of the realm of possibility that Andrew WK has been brewing his own mythos for his own entertainment? Perhaps even starting the original Dave Grohl rumor. Who knows? In the years since, nothing has been officially clarified. Interviews with Andrew WK have just muddled and distorted things further. Him varyingly admitting, revoking, and saying a sum total of nothing via enthusiastic yet contradictory statements. I want to confess something to all of you. I'm actually not Andrew WK. I'm not. I'm not the same guy that you may have seen from the I Get Wet album. I'm not that same person. And I don't just mean that in a philosophical or conceptual way. It's not the same person at all. Do I look the same as that person? What I mean is that since that time, I have changed. And for any of you that happened to be there during that time, perhaps you have changed as well. Rarely has an artist been so entwined with his own myth. Even when he's talking about partying, there's an element of strategic double talk. I actually party way harder than I would ever advise others to. I keep a lot of my most intense partying secret, mainly because it would probably upset some people, and because I don't want to go to prison. Staying out of prison while also partying extremely hard has always been one of my main life goals. So far, so good. 20 years later, the intrigue is still there. Who was that guy on stage in December 2004? Did Dave Grohl have anything to do with it beyond that support slot back in April 2000? Who knows? Musically, no one has taken up the wall of sound, ultra-positive, bubblegum metal of Andrew WK. Perhaps sleigh bells. They too have infinity guitars. But the internet era self-made myth can be seen in everyone, from the nameless ghouls of Ghost, the artificial concoctions of PC music, to the augmented reality of early Poppy. Andrew WK has always been the party guy, but since 2006, he has become more focused on self-help. In a similar way that he was using his music to deal with his own darkness, he has applied his relentless positivity to motivational speaking, a highly praised advice column in the Village Voice, as well as back into his music. Music is Worth Living For, off his long-delayed fifth album, 2018's You're Not Alone, commented on his career struggles and not giving up, but also the healing power of music.
Music makes me feel so
ending up on NPR's Top Songs of the Year. Music is Worth Living For rapturously rejects what he sees as toxic cynicism, pleading with listeners to soldier on with an open heart and never back down. It's an almost comically over-the-top anthem, to be sure, but not at all ironic. The world has never needed Andrew WK more. In 2018, he was named Person of the Year by the American Association of Suicidology for spreading positivity through his music and lyrics. As complex and confusing as his smokescreen of an identity is, the sentiment of Andrew WK's defining anthem, Party Hard, is strikingly simple, almost mantra-like. When it's time to party, we party hard. Any and all problems are silenced by this fortress of guitars, this pure, uncut serotonin. If things stop feeling alright, just play again but louder. The power of blind positivity and blaring, blood-pumping, feel-good music. Everything will be alright. Thanks for watching. So what is your take on Andrew WK? Major label experiment or self-made myth? Let me know by commenting down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you do me a favor and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. I'd also like to shout out all my new top tier supporters over on Patreon. Alicia Luma, Justin Darkangelo, Cutty Flam, Matt Black, and Austin Peters. Thank you so very much. And I'll see you in 4 weeks' time for... who knows?